Hello, this is Václav, and I'm gonna walk you through some of the main features of the Midilooper. In this video, we are going to focus on how to connect your setup. So we'll be talking about connectivity and how do you connect MIDI gear in general. So let's have this detail on the Midilooper, and let's look at the actual connectivity of this device. So in the back, we've got the main power input. So as soon as you power it up with USB, you can plug the USB into like really any USB charger or like anything that powers USB. You don't need to be connected to the computer at all. So this is just for the power. Now, the Midilooper doesn't really work with audio. So all it does, it takes MIDI information at the MIDI input, the main MIDI in, and then it loops the information and sends it to the two MIDI outputs. At the moment, the MIDI outputs output identical signals. So if you want to connect more than one synth to the Midilooper, you can use both outputs and they output exactly the same data. So you, by default, you don't really need a MIDI through box or like a MIDI splitter. You can connect to two devices just like that. So let's not focus too much on much else, and let's just get this simple setup going. So I have this keyboard. It's like a Rhodes piano type thing, and this one comes with like little dongle, and it is the MIDI in and MIDI out port. So you might see that on a bunch of synths. I'll be using this one to both as a keyboard and as the synth engine. So I'm just gonna connect the looper to loop this. So to start, I'm gonna take the MIDI out, connect the MIDI cable, and then on the Midilooper, I will go to the MIDI in. So now that this is connected, I can test that it's running. So as soon as I play a note, there should be a little dot that lights up on the first digit of the display. So that shows me that this connection is working. So again, MIDI out from the keyboard goes into the MIDI input of the Midilooper. Then I will take a second MIDI cable and connect one of the MIDI outputs. Right, and connect into the input MIDI jack of the CP. So now there isn't much of a difference. On some of the instruments you'll be working with, it might be really handy to turn off a local control, which is a this keyboard can do it. Just for your interest, if I hold down the F key, the lowest of octave, and I turn it on, it will change the setting of the local control. So basically what it's gonna do is that it's going to disconnect the keyboard from the voice engine, from the synth engine. So now that I turned it off, only when I switch to voice number A on the Midilooper, it's going to play the synth engine, which is on a MIDI channel number one. So now it's working. If I change voice on the Midilooper, it's not. So I can use the keyboard to control something else on MIDI channel number two. So when I'm sending the MIDI notes from the keyboard, each MIDI note has basically bunch of information baked into it. So one of them is like which note I'm playing. So let's say note C would be whatever note number 60 or I don't know. And then it would tell how hard I play the note. That would be the velocity or MIDI velocity. That's part of the message. And then I'm sending the MIDI note on a specific MIDI channel. So the MIDI protocol has 16 channels available. So with one type of MIDI cables, you can actually control up to 16 different instruments, where each one would be set to a different MIDI channel. So the Midilooper, it has three different voices you can use, and therefore you can use like three different channels to control three different instruments. So this synth engine is set up to be on MIDI channel number one. And on the Midilooper, when I want to set up the channel, what I do is I hold function and the voice button I want to be adjusting. And now it tells me one. And with the record and play, those buttons, they have these like arrow up and down. I can go and change the channel. So number one is the lowest. I can go up to 16. So if I'm on channel number two, it's not gonna play anything. If I go back to channel number one, the synth engine in the keyboard is gonna listen, because it's set to listen only on channel number one. I can also go to a second voice here on the voice B and change the voice B not to be on the second channel, but also on the first channel. And now it's gonna play. So it's gonna play on both A and B, and voice C is set to channel number three. This might be useful because these voices are independent and they can both have different settings. And yeah, at some points it gets useful. So now with this setup, I don't really have any like clock source or anything that gives me a tempo, but I don't really need that with the Midilooper. But before I start with the looping, I actually need to select the right clock source. So selecting clock source is done by holding the function button and then pressing the play stop button. So anything that has the rounded rectangle around it is the function that would respond the interface only when I hold down the function button. Actually, if you look at the back of the device, let me focus on this. There is a little like a cheat sheet. So in case you're somewhere and you forgot, you might need to pull out the full manual. You can just look at the back and see, okay, this is how I set up MIDI channel and so on. This is how I select clock source and so on. So back to this. And yeah, so selecting clock source, function and play stop. So now it's gonna cycle through a couple options. This arrow is pointing to the MIDI input. So that would listen to MIDI clock at the MIDI input. This would listen to analog clock at the clock input, or MIDI clock at the clock input. And this option is, it's either tap tempo or when it's blinking, it's a free running mode. And the free running mode, when I release the function, it says FR. And this mode is really the mode that works as most audio loopers would work. So in this mode, It will just listen to the moment where when I hit the record button. So when I get the looper ready for a recording, which could either be done by hitting the record button and then it starts blinking, so it's like waiting for the first MIDI note to start recording, or when I double tap the clear, that would clear all the voices and get ready for a new recording. Now it's listening. So let's try to make our first loop. Yeah, that easy. So there are a couple of ways how you can like start and end looping. So now it's playing. I can stop it. I can hit play to make it play again. So now if I would hit record, it would actually start playing, and now it's also recording, so I can overdub. So maybe I change octave here. So I have this switch here at the MIDI looper that actually says either overdub or overwrite. So when I'm recording on top of an existing loop, it can do either that or that. So if I would be in the overwrite mode, and as soon as I would play some notes, it would actually delete what's being left. So I can do that. So while I was holding the notes, it was actually deleting the content of what was recorded before. Most of the time I work in the overdub mode, but both are useful. Okay, so this is the recording. What I can do is that I can clear the recording. Or I can double tap the clear. So that so now, as soon as I do it, the record button is blinking, so it's ready to receive the first note, or it's ready to start recording. And to start recording, you can do it in two ways. Either you press a note on the MIDI input, or you play the play button, and that would be the start of the loop. So sometimes, musically speaking, you don't want to be starting with a note on the first downbeat. So I can do it like that. So the first downbeat was made when I pressed the play stop button. So anyway, most of the time I actually use rather the MIDI input. So let's make a new loop. And this is really how fast it is. It's like a single gesture. You just clear it and it's waiting already for your first note, and then you're making a new loop. So maybe now you remember that on the channel B, I did set up the channel B also to channel number one. So I could also use or record into channel B. But what I would do with the channel B is that I would give it an octave transposition. So each of those channels could be set to a different octave. You can also change the octave when I'm playing back. So if I go back to channel A and I hold function and transpose, that is the octave offset, I can... So now it's playing one octave higher. Octaves higher, or I can go also to like minus one octave or minus two octaves. But I can also use it as some sort of like a static filter. So if I go to channel B, go to octave offset, and I will be two octaves higher. So now I can, or maybe even three. So I can record the same type of voice, like really higher up. So I'm on channel B. So now channel A, channel B have different loops. I can clear just channel B. So when you're clearing, hitting it once will clear only the selected voice. If I would hit it twice, like double tap, like or double click on a mouse, it would clear all channels. Something else. So this way you can play with one instrument and have two different layers that you can be working with. Okay, so this is the most basic setup. Let's add one more instrument to this. So I've got this thingy here. This is like super old school. I don't even know how old this is. This is supposed to be like a piano and e-piano type rack unit. And so this is one of the older type MIDI gear. It's like really weird shape. And it's got, okay, connections at the back. So there is MIDI in, MIDI out, and MIDI through. So this is the type of connection you would see on a lot of older MIDI gear. A lot of them have the through output. So this keyboard I was showing, it has only in and out, but this one has in, out, and through. So what through is that it basically just takes the input and clones it into the through output. So it's gonna be identical signal without even going through the computing processor in the device. So, and that's actually really useful to have that, because then I don't need to split any of those signals. So what I would do is that I would take the cable that goes from the MIDI looper output. I would go to the input on this one. Right, and I would take another MIDI cable and go through the through, and I would go from the through back to the input on the CP. So now I think both of those devices should be reacting somehow on the MIDI. Let's see. Yeah, so this one is still playing. So again, I went from the MIDI out into the MIDI in on this Roland voice, took the MIDI through from the Roland voice and went to the input, the MIDI in on the CP. So this unit is just forwarding the MIDI into the keyboard, but now it should be also listening to what I'm playing here. So I'll connect the audio cable and see if we're getting. So this is another. So it actually sounds a bit like a e-piano as well. Let's see. So this unit, it actually has three different voices I could be playing. Each one of them is set to different MIDI channel. So there is a piano on channel number two, on channel number three. There is some other e-piano. Oh, and then some sort of spinet type thing on channel number four. So Yeah, I can use that. That's funny. So, yeah. So now I have both connected and I can just go looping again. So I'm recording and let's say I want to do something, or I'll stop recording and maybe, So I'll maybe go one octave lower on this. Yeah, or maybe even two octaves lower on. Wow, that's a lot of high end. Cool. So let's do a loop. Okay, maybe my timing wasn't the best, but I can add another layer here. Okay, so this is sort of like the basic setup running in the free running mode, and let's maybe move on and see how we can synchronize it to a drum beat or to something else. So now we have the drum machine here, and let's see what are the ways how we can sync the MIDI looper to the drum machine and yeah, have a bit more tight thing going on. So this is the drum machine. Now it's not synced in any way. One of the ways how you can sync, but I don't really recommend that, but it's possible. Maybe that's useful in like a band scenario. You can use the tap tempo on the MIDI looper. So when I'm browsing the tempo sources, there are five available. This arrow is the clock, MIDI clock at the MIDI input, but the keyboard doesn't really give any MIDI clock. Some others do. Then there's the option of N. We'll get to this one later. Anyway, we were on this one when it was blinking. That's the free running mode, you remember? And then when it's not blinking, it is actually tap tempo. So I can hold function and tap the clear button a couple times, try to set up the tempo, and then it should be in some sort of like a loose thing. So sort of, but yeah, it's probably gonna go out of phase pretty soon, but better than I expected anyway. So let's look at the tight sync. So this drum machine, it has a MIDI output right here. I can show it on the close-up cam. So see, it's already out of sync. So let's do it properly. So there is a MIDI out, and this drum machine also has a trigger out, which would be another option how to sync it, and maybe even more interesting one. But the MIDI looper, it has a dedicated clock input. It's this mini jack here. Yeah, so there's the clock input. It's this mini jack, and it can accept both analog clock or a MIDI clock. So in case you don't have a setup where you can merge the MIDI clock or the MIDI information from your drum machine or your workstation or whatever like is your clock source with the keyboard that you're looping, this is where it comes handy. So I have this cable with this adapter. So this is the adapter you're going to need. It has a MIDI input on one end and DRS mini jack on the other end. So this is the thing that can connect in here. So I'll connect the MIDI cable through this, and I'll connect the other end of the MIDI cable to the MIDI output here on the drum machine. So I connect it here to the clock input. Now I'm gonna select it as an input source. So hold function and go through play stop again. And MIDI clock at the clock input is the record LED blinking. Yeah. So now it should accept the clock. And when I'm connecting clock and the MIDI looper is not running, very useful thing to look at would be, let me see, can we actually see it? Or did it disconnect? No, it's, not sure how well you can see it on the camera now. So this LED on the right digit, it's blinking, and that's basically blinking with the tempo source. And that's really useful when you're setting up. So the left one blinks that I'm receiving my note informations on the MIDI input, and the right LED is showing me the presence of the clock. So it's blinking with quarter notes, and that's actually super useful. So. Now I'm gonna play the beat. Oh, what's it doing? That's not the beat I wanted. Okay. So now the dot is blinking with the tempo, and I should be ready to go. So let's see. Right, it's in sync. So syncing with MIDI clock is probably the best way to really work, but it's always like very predictable and very tight. The cool thing is when I stop this, it stops the MIDI looper. When I start it, it starts the MIDI looper. So when you're using MIDI clock, there are a few types of messages. There is the actual clock, which runs at 24 pulses per one quarter note. But then there is also start and stop message, continue message, and stuff like that. So it can like automatically start the MIDI looper when you press start. However, maybe sometimes that's not what you want, but then like another option could be syncing with an analog clock, which could also be a lot more creative. So, yeah, I'm perfect sync. Maybe I'll build up a loop while we're here. There is still this voice module from Roland connected. If we can you see it? It's down here. It's hiding under the drum machine. So this one is still connected. Let's use the trigger output on the drum machine now. Let's see. I hope you can see it. All right. So there is the trigger output, and when I press this button, I'm editing the triggers. So like to start, it's important to kind of, what am I doing now? Am I not editing? So I kind of need to put trigger on every single step. So now it's gonna, put the pulses. It's basically gonna be like an analog clock that I want. So I'll disconnect this. You see it stopped playing. Easy. So I'll connect it with the normal mono cable. But I need to change the clock source, so now it doesn't know it's not gonna get MIDI clock. So I'm gonna go that the record LED is still, and that means analog clock at the clock input. So you can hear it's already in sync, but it doesn't reset. It doesn't like restart the sequence when I work with the analog clock, which is fine. So let's make something fun here. I'll quantize it. All right. So I've got this like relatively simple sequence. And what happens if I start removing triggers from the clock? So I'll remove two. So you hear it like misses two of the clocks, and then it gives me some sort of like polymetric workflow. If I remove four, it's gonna be repeating with every like three beats. Can work with that. If I add the clocks, it's back on the grid. I can restart it. Yeah. So this is syncing to analog clock. It has its advantages. It's a bit more creative. When you work with like a modular synth or stuff like that, you might also have the reset signal available. I don't really have it on this drum machine, but basically what the reset input does is that it jumps to the first step. So the moment I start recording, so we go to this first beat if I send the pulse into the reset input. That's basically what it would do. And I could also send like irregular triggers, or I can just send it like once every while, or just use it basically to reset the sequencer. That's the initial or the main idea behind the reset input in the first place. But you can use it a lot more creatively. You can use it to make polyrhythms. Yeah. Yeah, removing triggers, I highly recommend. Cool. So these are two methods of how you can like tightly sync or like do it a bit more creatively. And yeah, maybe let's have a look at some of the other connections the Midilooper provides. So these four jacks on the side, they're super fun. So they sort of like bring up the next dimension to the Midilooper, really. So there is the metronome output. So I can plug in headphones to this. So this is like super useful. When, let's say, I have the drum machine running, it's giving me the MIDI clock. So I can start actually looping and hear just the metronome on the headphones, and then I don't need to hear the beat. So I can like first start with some chords and then start the beat. So that's super useful. Then there is a re-trigger input. We might try that in a little sec. There is a velocity input. So you can use that to pump up velocity for certain notes, or use it to like modulate the velocity with an LFO. So that's a CV input. there is also a transpose input, so you can use like voltages from your module to actually transpose the MIDI information. So all that is super useful, but these three inputs, they have an alternate function, so they can also work as pedal inputs for record, clear, and changing voices. So if you are working in a setup where you really like, you know, you need your hands, you need your both hands for, I don't know, maybe you have a wind controller with MIDI, or you have drum pads, maybe you need to use a foot pedal to control the MIDI looper. And it really takes pretty much any type of button. So I've got this like funny thing just to fit in the frame. So this would be like, this is how most like sustain pedals look. There is like some sort of like simple button in it, and then it just connects to the cable, and basically it just connects the tip and the sleeve, and that's what foot pedal is. So you can connect any type of sustain pedal to these inputs. You just need to convert them to the small jacks, so you get these adapters that are like really cheap. So to set up the CV/pedal inputs, basically what you do is that I need to hold one of the voices for like 5 seconds, and then it shows me on these LEDs for which of these inputs is affecting the voice. So now voice A would be affected by the re-trigger. If I hold voice B, I can see, and I can remove all of them. Voice B is not influenced by any of the CV inputs because all the lights are off. And if I hold voice C, I see that also it's not influenced by anything. So if the CV input is not activated for any of the voices, this input will act as the pedal input. So I deactivated basically all the CVs for all the voices. So then when I go to the record, you can see that pressing the pedal or the button turns on and off the recording. Okay, so I can have that as a foot switch, or you can build your own switch. You can, I don't know, move your arms to do that, whatever. It also kind of works with triggers from the modular, but the polarity is inverted. I can also use it for the clear button, or I can use it to change voices. So each press of the button would change, it would cycle through the voices like that. So yeah, so that can be like really useful. And yeah, so let me show you the re-trigger input for a little sec. I will make another video that's only gonna focus on the CV inputs, but let's just do it for in this connection video so you get the idea. So I'll go back to using MIDI clock with the drum machine. Cool. And now if I connect, I need to hold voice A for a few seconds and activate the re-trigger for voice A. Or maybe, you know what, I'll do it for voice C. It's gonna be a bit more fun. Okay, so voice C, this is gonna be re-triggered with the triggers from the drum machine, so. So I'll plug it in. And this is basically what the re-trigger does. Now I'm basically feeding a clock. I can. So it can also re-trigger whole chords. So that's a lot of fun. So I believe this type of connectivity really expands the usefulness of the Midilooper. And yeah, I think this is about it for the connection video. I was outreaching to different areas, but I believe saying things twice doesn't really hurt. So in the next video, we're gonna look at the actual looping mechanism. There's gonna be another video about using the CV inputs and so on. So yeah, tune up for the next one. Cheers. This is Václav from Bastl Instruments, from our lovely store in Prague, Noise Kitchen. Stop by if you're ever in town. See you in the next one.